My friend John was in sales. He spent his entire career doing presentations to sell the company's products. But every now and then, the company insisted he took an engineer with him to explain how the products worked. On one occasion, John introduced the engineer who put up their slide. He stared at it for about 20 seconds and said, "I think that's fairly self-explanatory." This talk is not about the misuse of PowerPoint, although there's probably scope for it. This is about a common inability amongst engineers, scientists, people you might call technical experts, to explain what's in their head in a way that we can all understand, but because it's frustrating. If you've been in that audience, you'd have every right to feel frustrated because that slide is not self-explanatory to anyone. But it's equally bad for the engineers. They just can't see why that isn't clear and obvious to all of you. So they get frustrated. In 2017, the frustration in scientists had built up to almost mild annoyance. They stormed onto the streets of Washington to protest that the government didn't listen enough to what they have to say. And amongst the banners and flags they waved about, the one that caught my attention said, "At the start of every disaster movie, the government ignores the scientist." I think that's probably true in the movies, don't you? Yeah, and often with dire consequences. However, I found throughout my long engineering career that the real life consequences of miscommunication can be far worse. The first thing you're likely to notice if managers don't understand engineers, it throttles innovation. Imagine being poor Steve Sasson in 1975. You've just developed the world's first digital camera and you're excitedly explaining how it works and the impact it's going to have on the world to your bosses at Kodak. They didn't get it. They said, "It's cute, but don't tell anybody about it." Of course, years later, they filed for bankruptcy. Where do you think Kodak might be now if they'd understood what was in Steve's head? And this misunderstanding that happens between managers and technical experts often causes bad quality decisions to be made in the organisation. January 2003, shortly after the Space Shuttle Columbia had launched, NASA realised that a lump of foam had come off a tank support and hit the front edge of the left wing. Now, they did exactly the right thing. They reported it to the Flight Design Authority, who were Boeing. Boeing analysed it and reported back in their time-honoured way on PowerPoint. The first time that presentation was delivered, it was probably clear because it was supported by Boeing engineers. But thereafter, only the PowerPoint deck went up the organisation. Based on that information, they made the decision to bring Columbia back in. Sadly, as we know, on the 1st of February, somewhere high over Texas, Columbia exploded on re-entry, killing all seven souls on board. That has to be the ultimate cost of miscommunication. Of course, there was an investigation and the misuse of PowerPoint got some criticism. But for me, the most chilling conclusion in the report was that the people at the top of the organisation probably didn't realise they were making a life or death decision. And that's what can happen when management doesn't understand the messages coming from technical experts. Now, I thought this was an old problem because when I graduated, back in the dark ages, my role model was a chap called Lee Iacocca. And I felt we had great similarity because we were both graduate mechanical engineers entering business. But that's where the similarity stopped. He went on to become the CEO of the Ford Motor Company and later Chrysler too. So he's a real management giant. And if you read his autobiography, you'll find it's littered with quotes about the cost of poor communication. But one I particularly remember, he said, "I've known lots of engineers with terrific ideas who had trouble explaining them to other people. It's always a shame when a person with great talent can't tell the board or committee what's in their head." But as I say, that was a long time ago. You'd think by now, wouldn't you, that they'd fixed that, that things had got better. Well, I thought so till a while ago, and I was listening to a podcast featuring Scott Berinato. Now, he's the senior editor for data visualization at Harvard Business Review. And the very first words out of his mouth in the interview, he said, "I hear one continuous problem." He said the big challenge for lots of teams who are generating smart ideas through their data science and significant investment is they cannot communicate them to the business or the executives. So 50 years forward, and not much progress, it seems. Why? Why is it such a challenge? And what really goes on in an engineer's head? In 10 minutes, I don't think so. I'll stick with a couple of things. The first challenge for engineers is they're too smart. Now, you wouldn't think that was a problem, would you? But it is. They suffer the curse of knowledge. They can't visualize what it's like to look at a problem without the benefit of their education and experience in their head. So they tend to dive into the deep detail far too quickly. Now, good communication goes from big picture to small detail. It's something I call jigsaw lid communication. You ever tried doing a jigsaw without the lid? I have. I can tell you it's an absolute nightmare. And yet, if we create that big picture, if we put the jigsaw lid down, several people can work together quite easily on the same puzzle because they all understand what each other's doing and where every piece fits. Because with big picture comes relevance and understanding. The second challenge for engineers, technical experts, they're built upside down to managers. Now, engineers are typically what we would call bottom-up thinkers. They love to start with first principles, and then they put on every layer of their thinking and their analysis and their research and testing until they reach the final climatic conclusion. This is what we've proven. However, managers are the other way up. They like to be top-down thinkers. They like to start with a big picture. What they want is to understand, in summary only, where all the pieces are, how they fit together, how they relate to one another. And then once they've got that big picture clear, they do not want all the information. They want to cherry pick the bits that are of interest to them only. And they certainly don't want all the data on an endless parade of densely bullet-pointed PowerPoint slides. That, in my opinion, is the quickest qualification route to chartered anaesthetist. Nobody wants that, so what can we do about it? Well, I think if you're a technical expert, there are three things you can do about it. The first is you can follow the Feynman method, named after Richard Feynman, the Nobel Prize-winning physicist. Did you know, when he was at Princeton University, he had a book of things that he didn't understand. And he used to work tirelessly on them to make them so simple and clear that everyone could understand them. Now, his method is if you can explain your subject to an 11-year-old and they get it, then you know two things. Firstly, you know your subject very well. Secondly, most business audiences will understand it. Now, I know, there's never a convenient 11-year-old around when you want one, is there? No. So try finding someone who doesn't know about your subject and explain it to them, because if they get it, then the business audience will get it. The second thing you can do, you can structure a presentation using the journalist triangle, which is the method most journalists use to write newspaper articles. Now, it's got three parts. First, of course, the headline. Grab your attention, make you want to read the article and give you the essence of what's in the story. The second part they always write, the first paragraph. It has all the important facts and dates and people and names that you need in order to understand the story. And then the third part is the narrative, which they generally write to fill the column inches they've been given. But you can present like that too. Start with an impact statement. This is why this subject is important. This is why you should listen to it. And what's it all about? And then the equivalent of the first paragraph, write an executive summary. Again, all the important facts, information that people need in order to understand your presentation. Now, those two bits together form the big picture. And if that's the only thing your audience go away and remember, then they will at least go away with a good understanding of your presentation. And then for the third part, do something unusual for presenters. Stop talking. Turn it over to Q&A. Now, this works particularly well for technical experts presenting to managers, because we can often characterize managers by one key word, and the word is control. They just love to be in control, don't they? Now, if you turn it over to Q&A, they're in charge, so they're in their happy place. The second benefit you get is you no longer have to worry about your content, because they'll ask questions about the bits they're interested in. And lastly, you don't have to worry about the timing of your presentation, because when they've had enough, they stop asking questions and you're done. It's so much easier to present to people with what they want to listen to rather than throw everything at them and hope the relevant bits stick. The third thing that you could do, become a presentation pioneer. Do something different and see how it affects your audience. Now, most of the problems I see with presenting are cultural. People will always do what they've always done. So if they've always churned out PowerPoint decks, they'll carry on doing it forever. But you can do something different and change that. Jeff Bezos managed it at Amazon. In 2004, he banned PowerPoint. But he replaced it with something very sensible. He made every presenter write a 6-page maximum report. And then at the start of the meeting, all the attendees had to sit and read it. And then they started discussing it. It worked brilliantly. And it's such a powerful technique. I've seen leaders and senior politicians do exactly the same, except perhaps they only ask for a 2- or 3-page summary and then ask their questions on that. So it's a fabulous technique. And those three techniques together would help technical experts communicate effectively, because we need them to. We need them because they have such bright ideas that are going to make our life better in the future, as long as they can explain what's in their head so that we can all understand it. But if they do, leaders and managers will get behind them and we'll find more of their brilliant ideas become reality. Thank you.